사랑에서 온 박형숙입니다. 저는 질병을 세 개나 가지고 있었고요. 간경하고 3, 4년 됐습니다. 그리고 방광암이 있고 예방을 받았습니다. 방광암은 세발이 7, 80%가 된다고 합니다. 그리고 당뇨도 심합니다. 그래서 이 지인의 소개로 입회 내려왔습니다. 3개월 있다가 또 병원에 진단받으러 가고 3개월 지나고 나면 또 받으러 가고 이렇게 살아왔습니다. 그런데 저로서 저한테는 너무나 가혹한 힘든 일이었습니다. 그래서 이제 지인의 소개로 이제 입회 내려와서 이제 이렇고 저렇고 고지혈도 있고 이렇습니다. 이러니까 전도사님이 다 듣구나. 그러면은 오늘부터 음식을 하자고 이러더라고요. 그래, 올 때만 해도 살이 좀 많이 졌습니다. 언제까지 이제 금식을 합니까? 이러니까 한 3일 해보고 더 주어진다면은 또 좀 더 하고 이제 봅시다 이러더라고요. 그래서 이제 물금식을 3일 했습니다. 그러고 나서 참 참기가 힘들더라고요. 세상에서 너무 많이 먹고 이래가지고. 그래서 그 다음에 이제 과일 금식이 들어갔어요. 그러고 이제 남편분도 체격이 좋으니까 같이 하자고 해서 같이 했습니다. 그러면 이제 금식하는 도중에 이제 운동도 다리에 근육이 붙어야만 당뇨가 떨어진대요. 그리고 요 올 때 380이 나왔어요. 그리고 인슐린을 5개 가지고 약을 3개월분을 가지고 이리 들어왔어요. 모든 걸 끊으라고 하더라고요. 그래서 저로서는 참 의아하더라고요. 과연 의학이 주는 약인데 과연 이 당뇨가 이리 높은데 끊어도 되겠는가 싶고 내 혼자서는 좀 망설였어요. 그러나 여기에서 하시는 거니까 이제 그러고 모든 걸 믿고 맡기자. 그래도 전도사님 약을 끊어도 되겠습니까? 하니까 믿고 맡깁시다 이러더라고요. 그래서 이제 믿고 이제 막 이제 안 먹었어요. 그러다가 한 3일 있다가 우리 아저씨가 감기가 왔어요. 아우 10일 동안에 엄청 제가 잠을 못 잤어요. 그래서 하루에 운동을 한 3시간 30분도 하고 3시간도 하고 일단은 운동을 좀 많이 했어요. 그러고부터 이제 우리 아저씨가 감기가 떨어지고 그러고부터 잠을 자고 이러니까 당뇨가 이제 제 위치로 가더라고요. 그러니까 저로서는 엄청 반가운 거예요. 이 당뇨로 인하여서 13년을 알았습니다. 이 당뇨로 인하여서 내가 간을 더 망가뜨렸는 거예요. 그래서 이제 이것만 해도 내 인대는 감사할 일이고 참 축복받았다. 이 온기 참 축복받았다. 그래서 내가 그분 지인한테 전화를 했어요. 집사님이 나를 여기 보내주셔서 당뇨가 지금 제자리로 가고 있습니다. 당뇨가 지금 오늘 아침에는 94가 나왔어요. 그러니까 그분이 엄청 좋아라 하시더라고요. 그래가지고 이제 나도 좋아라 하고 이래가 94, 105, 뭐 110 그 중간에서 정상 위치에서 맴도더라고요. 그래서 엄청 기쁘고 그때부터 내게는 힘이 솟기 시작했어요. 아 이런 곳이 있었기에 그러니까 자연으로 도착하자 한다. 그러면은 나도 지금부터는 내 삶을 바꿔야 되겠다. 그때부터 마음을 바꿨어요. 기도도 바꿨어요. 그래가지고 나는 하나님 내 병을 왜 나에게 이런 가시를 줘가지고 이렇게 힘들게 합니까? 원망만 하고 좌절감도 오고 참 이랬어요. 그래서 이제 그때부터 기도를 바꾸면 저부터 경우에는 온 산을 댕기면서 갈 때 찬송가를 세 개를 불러요. 내일은 난 몰라요. 주여 이 손 잡아주소서. 내가 그리스도와 함께 십자가에 죽었나니 이걸 하고 세 개를 부르고 또 내려오면 그 찬양을 또 반복해서 세 개를 해요. 그리고 물론 저 노래 들어보신 분들도 있을 겁니다. 산이 터져갖고 찬양을 크게 합니다. 그러고 나서 이제 한적한 곳에는 또 말이 없어요. 그러면 이제 기도를 해요. 그러면 이 기도를 하면 이 안경이 다 앞이 안 보여요. 왜? 지나온 것들이 필름처럼 지나가고 어리석게 살았고 하나님 이 제 몸에 제 몸도 하나님이 성전이라고 했는 이 몸을 함부로 한 것이 죄스럽고 그래서 한적한 곳에 가면은 기도가 되더라고요. 그러고 나서 이 생활이 너무나 기뻤어요. 즐겁고 그리고 산에 가는 게 즐거웠고 집에 있을 때는 누우면은 일어나기가 싫어요. 당뇨를 낫술라 하면은 운동을 해야 되고 간을 낫술라 하면은 운동을 하면 피로가 쌓이고 나로서는 엄청 힘든 일이었어요. 근데 여기 오고부터는 이 동산에 오고부터는 운동하는 게 즐거웠어요. 운동하는 게. 그러고 나서 1월 23일 날 입소했는데 2월 23일 날이 검사 날이에요. 그래 이제 집에 안 가고 여기에서 서울 삼성병원으로 검사하러 갔어요. 그 다음에 3월 9일 날 결과가 나와요. 그래서 이제 이번에 3월 9일 날 병원에를 갔어요. 병원에를 가가지고 12시 10분에 당뇨 가고 12시 50분에 간 검사 소화기내과 간 검사 가고 2시에 방광암 비뇨기과 가고 이래 돼 있어요. 그래서 이제 당뇨부터 가니까 그래 당뇨에서 교수님이 하는 말씀이 뭐 당 색소 혈상이 85까지 나와야 되는데 거기 이제 110이라고 그랬긴 해. 그것만 조금 이제 낮추면 이제 되겠다고 이러더라고요. 그래 약은 잘 먹고 있지요 이러더라고. 그렇다고 해서 아니요 할 수도 없고 예 할 수도 없어서 그냥 웃고만 웃었어요. 웃으니까 그래 약을 이제 3개월 줄 테니까 열심히 먹으라 하더라고요. 근데 저는 여기 와서는 약을 전혀 안 먹었어요. 인슐린도 전혀 안 먹었어요. 그대로 하고 3개월 후에 고작하고 이제 운동만 조금 더 하락하고 이랬어요. 그러는데 그러고 나서 이제 당뇨 검사하는 거 측정해주는 그 또 간 선생님이 있어요. 그래 또 그리 오라 하더라고요. 한 10분 공간에 있는데 그리 가면은 그 이제 기계로 이제 내 몸을 상태를 이제 검사를 해요. 그런데 그걸 딱 하니까 너무 많이 변화가 많이 됐대요. 근데 이 당 근육이 거의 정상치에 왔대요. 정상치에 다 왔고 복부 비만만 조금 빼라 하더라고요. 복부 비만이 좀 있으니까 지금 53kg 나가니까 3kg를 빼라 하더라고요. 그런데 그 3kg를 빼고 지금 하는 것만 운동하라고 해서 그렇게는 약은 이제 내는 안 먹으면 되고 처방전은 받아와도 그리 약은 타지는 안 했습니다. 안 하고 이제 간검사를 갔어요. 간검사를 가니까 교수님이 9개월 전에 간마취가 380이었어요. 간마취 이거는 높으면은 간 황달이 오고 배에 복수가 차요. 엄청 위험한 거예요. 그래가지고 남자는 40이고 여자는 30이에요. 그러니까 간마취가 380이 올라가고 엄청나죠. 그러니까 그리고 그 다음에 또 3개월 있다가 하니까 또 370이 올라가고 10만 떨어졌어요. 그래가지고 여기 와서 2월 23일 날 검사하러 갔잖아요. 간마취가 370 되는 게 150으로 뚝 떨어졌어요. 얼마나 기쁜 일인지 몰라요. 날아갈 것 같더라고요. 그래가지고 간마취가 뚝 떨어졌어요. 그래가지고 이제 원장님 하실 거 아니에요. 교수님 하시는 말씀이 우루사 외에는 뭔 거 없어요 이러더라고요. 내가 먼 거는 없는데 제가 좀 산에를 좀 들어갔어요. 그리고 거기에는 식이요법을 하는데 음식을 야채로 주로 하고 견과류를 쓰고 이렇다. 그리고 이제 병원에서는 방광암이 있어도 단백질을 먹어야 된다고 간 때문에 단백질을 필히 먹어야 된대요 저는. 그래서 이제 그래 교수님 보고 이제 산에 가서 이래 했다 이러니까 그런데 나도 한번 가봤으면 좋겠다 이러더라고요. 그러니까 둘이가 기쁜지 몰라요. 그래서 이제 그 이제 마치고 이제 방광으로 갔어요. 비뇨기과로 이제 2시 예약해내서 갔어요. 가니까 거기에는 이제 저 같은 경우에는 피를 한번 가면 8대 봉을 빼요. 왜냐면은 간이 4개 가져가고 비노이과에서 방광암을 3개 가져가고 당뇨에 1개 가져가요. 네드름을 뽑는데 여기에서는 햇볕, 물, 수면, 공기 최고로 친다니까. 그래서 이제 제 같은 경우에는 피를 두 대롱을 빼고 나면은 이게 피가 잘 안 나와요. 피가 탁하기 때문에, 당뇨 때문에 탁하기 때문에 잘 안 나오는데, 그렇기는 얘네들이 이제 간호사가 빼면은 주사기를 뺐다 꼽았다 또 눌렸다 내보고 주먹을 펴라 쥐라만 이래 해요. 그래가지고 반대롱식이라고 일단 8개를 빼요. 그런데 이번에는 여기에 있다가 한 달 있다가 하니까 피가 꼽아가지고 빼기만 빠요. 엄청 좋죠? 그러니까 피가 쫙쫙쫙쫙 나오는 거예요. 그리고 피가 꼽았다 깨고 다 빠요. 간호사가 하는 말이 한 손으로 이 한 하나들만 오면은 피가 엄청 뛰더라고요. 그래서 제가 참 감사할 일이다. 치료하는 여호와 신이 내가 진짜 감사하다 이러면서 이러면서 이제 나갔어요. 나와가지고 방광에 갔잖아요. 그래 방광에 가가지고 방광에는 피는 빼놨지만은 거기는 내시경을 진화해요. 네, 그 모니터를 보여줘요. 그래 갔는데 이런 모니터를 들고 이래 보니까 안에 한 흰줄 빨간 핏줄만 있지 뭐 보이는 게 없더라고요. 근데 그 전에는 내가 이래 보면은 좁쌀망 20배를 확대를 해놔요. 좁쌀망에 뻥긋뻥긋하게 이렇게 있어요. 그리고 요 생기고 막 이래 있는 이래 모니터를 딱 이렇게 보니까 이렇게 그 내시경을 하는데 그게 하나도 없는 거예요. 파란 흰줄만 보이는 거예요. 그래서 하나님 감사합니다 하고 이제 그러고 나서 이제 이걸 사진을 찍으면은 그게 암세포가 보이면은 얘네들이 발로 사진을 착착착착 찍어요. 사진 소리도 하나도 안 나고. 그래서 하느님 건지셨구나 감사합니다 하고 이제 나와서 옷을 입고 나와가지고 간호사한테 또 미리 물어서 간호사님 어떻습니까? 이렇게 뭐 없는 것 같은데 일단 교수님하고 상담해야 되니까 7번 방에 아까 기다리라 하더라고요. 그래가 이제 기다렸어요. 그런데 그 마음이 내가 눈으로 확인했기 때문에 마음이 엄청 편하더라고요. 그래 이제 이길 뿐이다. 그래서 이제 7번 방에 아빠가 기다리고 있으니까 부르더라고요. 그래서 내가 교수님 어떻습니까? 하긴 얼굴을 씩 쳐다보니까 웃어도 되겠네 이러더라고요. 그래서 별 다른 거 뭐 한 거 있어요 이러더라고요. 그래서 내가 산에를 갔는데 거기에서는 물을 많이 먹으라 하고 운동을 많이 하라 하더라고요. 나도 그러면 했잖아요 이러더라고요. 그래 맞아 교수님도 그래 했어요. 이거는 아마 하나님 은혜로 이게 다 치료된 것 같아요. 그렇게 해서 이제 기도를 제가 이제 하는 걸 바꿨어요. 한날 내가 하나님 뭐도 하고 싶습니다. 뭐도 합니다. 내 자녀가 잘 되고 뭐 한날 내 욕심만 채웠어요. 근데 기도를 바꿔가지고 이제 해야 되겠다 싶어서 마음도 먹었고 이제는 참 하나님이 내게 주어진 게 얼마 될랑가는 모르지만 남은 여생을 주님을 위해서 살고 싶고 남은 여생을 진짜 보험 전하면서 살고 싶습니다. 하나님이 최고입니다. 여러분에게도 이런 기회가 올 것입니다. 감사합니다.
It's awesome. It's how much changing your lifestyle, your eating habit and exercise, all those things can do to your body.
Amen.
I want to thank God. I want to thank this seminar. I'm really happy to hear those Bethel Sanitarium testimonies. It makes my heart up to God. I don't know how to say.
Yeah.
I'm really happy to have this kind of seminar. I want all of my friends to attend this meeting. Thank you, Pastor Arora and Pastor Barkat and all my friends.
Healthy relationships and stress. Many people are pursuing physical health while they are disregarding their mental and spiritual health. But if the balance of body and mind is broken, then they cannot recover the health of the whole person. mental vitality and spiritual strength are strongly affected by our physical strength and activity. As we improve our physical health, the foundation is laid for a healthy mind and balanced character development. Selfishness destroys human relationships. As a result, it leads to sickness of mind and body, ending in death. Today, the depression caused by mental suffering breaks up parents and children, husbands and wives, and other relationships. This depression results in children and spouses running away from home, murders, suicide, divorce, etc. A few years ago, when Mrs. Choi was holding a health seminar in Canada, a lady in her 60s came to her room. She opened her bag, Mrs. Choi says, and told me that she was taking 13 different types of medicines for hypertension, diabetes, heart illness, arthritis, insomnia, depression, stomach illness, etc. So many that she could not remember them all. But she said to me, "I believe if you could heal one of my sicknesses, then all of my sicknesses would be healed and I would not need any of this medicine." So I asked her, "What is that one sickness?" She said, "It is the sickness that I don't want to see my old man, my husband. I don't like him. Please, could you heal this sickness?" That lady held my hand and wept. She did not let go for quite a while. Though married couples might look good to other people, there is hardly a couple without struggles. Because of depression, the struggles between spouses, between in-laws and outlaws, and between parents and children, all relationships of today are worsening to the point that healthy relationships are becoming extinct. Among those who run away from home, get divorced, commit suicide, and do other terrible crimes, many are suffering from depression. Some time ago, a mother had in her house her three-year-old child. Her child and her neighbor's child were playing together. And she took them both to the roof of a high-rise apartment building and pushed them over the ledge, killing both of them. Another young person contracted someone over the internet to kill his mother. It was later revealed that both of these crimes were committed by people suffering from severe depression. In America, a mother of 5 children put very hot water in the bathtub and forced her children to go into the hot water and drown them one by one, and all 5 were killed. When police investigated, it was found that she also was suffering from severe depression. With whole families committing suicide together, couples divorcing, separating, violent driving, or road rage, etc., it is not an exaggeration to say that this world is a big mental hospital. In peaceful times, these people appear normal to society. Therefore, we are living in a very unsafe and unpredictable world. We never know when such an incident will take place. Therefore, it is best to diagnose and prevent depression at the beginning. This sickness needs to be treated, but it cannot be solved by modern medicine. In depression, the heart is suffering, and the cause is the same as other adult or lifestyle illnesses. Intemperate eating, immorality, guilt, overwork, stress, shock, postmenopause, etc., are often related to depression that is manifested with these symptoms. The person tries to hold their grief or other depressing feelings to themselves and to manage alone. As a result, their mind is always in darkness. Their heart is in pain and distress. There is no physical strength or will to pursue life. They lose their spiritual strength. Therefore, they always feel on edge, or uneasy and nervous feeling. They like to be alone, and they don't want to do any work that requires contact with people. They are short-tempered, and they often speak or act violently. They complain that their heart hurts, but other people do not understand. They often complain of despair, lack enthusiasm, and that they want to die. Their conversation is often negative and pessimistic, rather than being hopeful and positive. They are imbalanced, which is seen by intemperance in emotions, appetite, words, and actions. They are always sad and lonely, tending to weep easily. They suffer from insomnia. They become selfish, and instead of trying to understand others, they want to be understood and get sympathy from others. They are very sensitive and can become greatly frustrated by the smallest matter. They are greatly stressed when others don't follow my way of thinking. If they think that someone else is causing them trouble, they will talk bad about that person and will surmise evil about that person, presenting it as truth, talking and believing like that person is their enemy. They often avoid that person, sometimes even wanting to kill them. If a wife was hurt by her husband, when she merely sees the shoes her husband wore when he hurt her, she still remembers what was done to her. Even a little thing might trigger her memories to pour out like a flood. Even when they have been married for 50 years, she may recall hers from the beginning of their marriage. A daughter-in-law who was hurt by her mother-in-law may feel the hurt when she just hears the name of the town where her mother-in-law lives. Saying that part of the body has inflammation, the slightest wind will make the body feel the pain. In the same way, if a person's heart suffering, even a little thing will cause old hurts to rise up. Therefore, they don't like that person, they don't want to see that person or hear their voice. They want to get rid of the club that hurts them. So they try to kill the person who hurt them. If they cannot get rid of the club, they run away from home, get divorced, or commit suicide. Children may react very sensitively to their parents' words, act rebelliously and avoid conversing with their parents, or run away from home often. These children are sick from depression. If they suffer stress from their parents, they grow up as children with a bad temper. When parents point out faults that they need to correct, it does no good. Rather, they consider those who give them advice as their enemy. So these hurt souls, they need a remedy. Of course, depression is a sickness that can be healed. If self or some members of the family have some of these symptoms, instead of concerning these people, seek to comfort. Instead of cornering these people, seek to comfort, understand, and help these people to be healed. When we deal with sickness of the mind, we need to understand them with great care and wisdom. With minds that are sick and in despair, we must use tender remedies that will touch their hearts. In many occasions, family problems will weaken the vitality of soul and body. In these cases, the person needs to remove the cause of depression by a healthy lifestyle. Many will need to change their whole life pattern and locate in environments that can help improve their health. We must help them find relief from the burden that has hurt them. If the matter was related to their environment or to a relationship, then they may need to get away from that environment or person for a while, going, traveling, or changing their surroundings. Patients need to have opportunity to heal their heartaches by a change of surroundings. But unless the patient himself prays for his own recovery, even these efforts will not be of help. As we decide to pray and put forth our own effort, then God will help. Most depression comes from selfishness. Understanding the essence of faith and establishing right values in life is very important for a person to gain spiritual vitality. Stress is not something that comes from others, but it is something that I receive myself. If I am changed, then stress disappears. Before I blame others, first I need to recognize my own problems, correct myself, and repent. Depression can be easily healed, but since it can return any time, constant effort is needed. A few years ago, a mother in her 30s who was suffering severe depression came to me. Mrs. Choi is talking, okay? As soon as she opened her mouth, her tears prevented her from continuing what she wanted to say. Her own two children ran away from home after 7 years of marriage because of her husband's violence. Until now, on numerous occasions, she had to run away from home with her children to her parents' home. She had dated her husband for 6 years and then married him. 1 year later, she got pregnant. But because of severe morning sickness, there was an argument between her and her husband during the whole pregnancy. Her husband could not understand his wife, and his complaints made her very sad, sorry, and disappointed in her husband. This was the beginning of disputes between husband and wife. In her second pregnancy, this lady again had the same morning sickness, and her husband accused his wife, saying that she was very disorderly. Her house was disorderly, and she could not prepare a normal meal. Of course, that happened because of her taste buds had changed during her morning sickness. He said, "All other ladies do these things. Why aren't you able to do it?" When she tried to defend herself or explain her side, he began to beat her. Although she was afraid of her husband's violence, she didn't say anything to anybody else. But these problems continued at least every 2 weeks or so. When these problems happened, she could not always run to her parents' house. And she feared that if she divorced, she will not be able to raise her children by herself. As days passed by, her anxiety and fear and tension grew. She began suffering indigestion, insomnia, and mental and physical weakness. And now she had lost the desire to live for her children. When her children played and closed the door loudly, it reminded her of her husband's violence. When her husband finished his work and came home, when she heard his footsteps, her body trembled with fear. More and more she avoided her husband. And beginning a year ago, they slept in separate rooms. Now her husband's violence became even worse. She could not endure the violence, so she again escaped to her mother's home. Her mother noticed her condition, serious condition. So she brought this lady to the Bethel Sanitarium. To a person in this condition, we cannot say, "Oh, you need to persevere. You need to be more patient." If we leave her as she is, she will probably have mental problems and become an invalid. In this case, we needed to find the cause and solve the problem for the husband and for the wife. About 3 weeks after she came to Bethel, the lady came to my room. Mrs. Choi is talking. The lady came to my room with a lot more peaceful expression. "I've been thinking about it. I think it's all my fault. I would like to get my children that I left with my parents, and I would like to go back home. How can I go about doing that?" So Mrs. Choi said, "Are you sure you can do that?" She said, "Yes, I believe I need to do it for the sake of my children. But in fact, I'm not sure if I can endure my husband's violence." She made up her mind that once again she needed to have courage to go on with her life. But since nothing had changed on her husband's side, this lady's resolution was sure to be destroyed soon. That afternoon, the lady gave me her husband's phone number, Mrs. Choi is talking. I called him, and after finishing his work, he came to Bethel. He quickly said in a curt voice, a coarse voice, "Why is that person in this kind of a place?" I answered, "I beg your pardon. If a husband does not know, if a husband does not understand why a wife is in this kind of a place, then who can know it? Who can understand?" Just as I speak to my own children, I said a few words, and then I explained the lady's condition in great detail to her husband. The husband responded as if there was no problem at all. "Why should these things happen just because a man gets upset? If she runs away every time something like this happens and gets sick because of that, how can I help? If she behaved herself, why would there be any reason that I would get upset?" So in this region of South Korea, men were typically quite violent and unsympathetic towards their wife. Now I said, "Are you going to continue to give your wife a hard time like that? If so, your wife will soon need to be admitted to a mental hospital, or she will divorce you. Which path would you like to take? Think carefully. It seems to me that in this situation, there are only two ways." After a period of silence, he asked me in a whisper, "Then what do you think I should do?" "You need to throw away your club. Your wife is responding to her husband's violence sensibly. The condition of your wife is much worse than you think. There is a time when if a man wants to save his wife and children and protect the home, he must surrender his own thoughts and temperament." His voice was rather calm, and he said, "Yes, I will do so." So Mrs. Choi told him, "Go and persuade your wife and take her back home." After that, about a year later, in a health seminar, by coincidence, I met his wife's mother. I asked her, "How's your daughter doing nowadays?" She responded, "After that experience, my son-in-law's violence disappeared, and they are getting along well." Amen. People can be changed at any time. Try to help each other. This couple's trouble was simple. If the husband was willing to give up the club, then they could be recovered. We also can easily face our troubles, find a resolution, and be recovered. When our trouble is with health or with the marriage, there is a solution. If people stubbornly hold on to their opinion and keep on complaining and resent other people, and if they make no efforts to correct themselves, many people will suffer from misfortune. People will be recovered by accepting the physical, mental, and spiritual laws of life. Therefore, people who suffer from mental injury need a healthy living environment. Give them a change in their environment, remove the cause of distress, and help them to solve the fundamental problems that burden them. They need to start anew with new health and hopefulness. To accomplish a big change, the whole family need to understand each other and work together. They need to understand God's love, His gospel that will give their life new strength. The life of faith supplies what we need for mental, physical, and spiritual recovery. As we keep the law of health and through Bible study, we must change our thoughts. The Bible is the book that changes people's hearts. I found this cup in our shelf. When the moment we saw it, we bought it. Can you read it? The confusion created when one's mind overrides the body's basic desire to choke the hell out of someone who desperately deserves it. This is the definition of stress by somebody. And this is what many of us have gone through in life. We want to choke the hell of someone who desperately deserves it. And we cannot do that because of our circumstances, and we become stressful. And that can lead to even a heart attack. Stress affects people not only mentally, but it can affect the physical system, leading to death. Unless our stress is resolved, we will suffer mentally and physically and cannot expect recovery. However, there are many people who have wrong thoughts regarding stress. That is, they think that others are giving them stress or they are causing them stress. However, but stress is not given by someone else. It is received by me. If I don't receive it, the person cannot force it on me. If I don't want to have stress, I must change my own thoughts. God says, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy on him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. God's heart and our heart meet together when our thoughts meet God's thoughts, and that is done through His Word. Let us meet those facts in the Word of God. This world is not the kingdom of heaven. Let us recognize that all the people who live in this world are sinners. And what comes out of sinners is sin only. Romans chapter 3 verse 10 to 12 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. they are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. So what comes out of sinners is only sin. Therefore, if we expect love from sinners, there will be conflict. We can only receive that love from heaven when we receive Jesus Christ through righteousness by faith. Our mind meets God's mind. Only then we can receive from God and give to God. Therefore, we should seek for love. Therefore, we should not seek for love from people. We need to seek it from God only. And we need to receive that love that God has already made available by faith. We need to see a division between sin and the sinner. The sins that sinners are committing is not done on purpose. They are not intentionally committing it. They inherited their sinful nature from Adam, and they are caught by the law of sin. They are victimized. Therefore, they do not understand what they do and why they do. And also, they cannot escape from that sin on their own. Lord Jesus, He hates sin. But He has pity on the sinners. And He loves them. But sinners love sin and hate the other sinners. These sinners need the Savior who will set them free from their sin. Therefore, instead of resenting those who are hurting me, I need to teach them about Jesus, who will save them from the sins that are holding them captive. Jesus comes near to all people when they feel the pain of sin. He comes near with a deep sympathy. Jesus says, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Because Jesus has already paid the price, He offers forgiveness of their sins. In this world, we need to recognize that no two people are the same. How many? No two people are the same. God has made them all differently. Romans chapter 9 verse 21. What does it say? Romans 9:21. Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? There are many occasions that an exalted person does not have some strength that a lower person has. We often accuse other people who are different than we are that they are wrong. But it's not wrong to be different from others. Therefore, people are to help each other. God created each one of us differently. And when these differences are united in Christ, it will result in most beautiful harmony. Psalm 103 verse 1 and 3 says, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore." When we were born, we did not bring anything into this world. Therefore, we need to admit that nothing is mine. We need to realize that nothing is mine. I came with nothing. the things that we have are not all ours. All these things are from God, prepared by the Creator God. God gave us all of these things in order that we might use them according to His will. As we use these blessings according to God's will, we are preparing our character for life in heaven. When people obey the word of God, that is, when we use what God gave us according to His will, we give glory to Him. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice, says the Lord, and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and holy nation. When the object of our belief is wrong, we will not only have conflict, but we may lose our salvation. No matter who it is, no human being is to be the object of our faith. You may remember through your own experience that many times you have trusted in people and you were disappointed. The God who created human beings says that we should not make any person or other God the object of our faith. I think it is Psalms 146, verse 3. He says, put not your trust in the princes nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. His breath goeth forth and he returneth to his earth. And in that very day his thoughts perish. So do not put your trust in the leadership. Put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Only trust me, says the Creator God. When the Creator God says, remember the Sabbath day, we must trust and follow the Creator God. And this commandment is telling us to remember not to trust anyone but the Creator God. The reason is that all of our life and our needs are received from Him. And we can only live when we are connected to Him. People were created to have a helping and healthy relationship. And God planned that we should have a relationship with Him by faith. When we put our faith in another human or a false God, we will experience sickness, misfortune, or even death. Human beings need to share with those who are in need of the blessing that they receive from God by faith. When this principle is practiced in human relationships, all the stress that was caused by putting our trust in other humans or false gods will disappear. All of our life is included in the above 5 points. Live and think contrary to these points, we experience sickness and misfortune. But when we think in harmony with God's word, we accept all of those points as facts, and the resentment caused by our wrong thoughts will disappear. If we don't want to suffer stress, we need to change our thoughts. We need to live with the right faith relationship with the one who gave his son. This is another incident that Mrs. Choi is describing. on the first day of a health seminar that was starting in Washington, D.C. I had a consultation with a lady in her late 40s. The first word that she spoke was, "Though I wanted to attend this seminar several years ago, I had one fearful thought, and because of that, I hesitated until now. This time, my body was too painful, and I could not hold back anymore. But I am still worried." I said, "What do you mean by that?" "Since a long time ago, I have heard about your lectures. But if I learn about that Jesus that you have been talking about, there will be a change in my mind and I may forgive my husband, and I am afraid of that. I do not want to forgive." I could not but be shocked by her words. But that woman had a sad story to tell. She was a graduate of a very prestigious university, Women's University in South Korea, called Ewha Women's University. And her husband was also a graduate from a prestigious university, Seoul National University in South Korea, from a top university. They were well matched in that both of their families were of high profile. They both were from well-to-do family. They respected and loved each other, and they had a son and a daughter, and they migrated to America. They had a happy home. Then the problem began. The husband started dating another woman, but the husband was very caring at home to his family, so no one suspected him. When this lady had a phone call from a friend one day, that phone call tipped her off. She ran madly to the place where her husband was supposed to be, and saw that her husband was with another woman. At that moment, her chest throbbed like it was hit by a big club. From her head to her toes, it felt like she was having a seizure, and she barely made it. This woman did not want to believe that her husband was seeing another woman. She decided to give her husband some time, hoping that he had made just a momentary mistake and would be faithful to her. 1 month passed, 2 months passed. Her husband was no different than before the affair started. Still very caring at home. But the wife continued to spy on him, and the relationship with the other woman continued. Though she wanted to confront him and she wanted to question her husband, she knew that if she acknowledged that she knew what was going on, there would be a big argument, and she imagined the terrible results, so she was afraid to open her mouth. But after 6 months, the lady could hold it no longer. She packed all of her husband's belongings in the luggage bags and placed them in the front porch. on the front porch of her house. When her husband arrived home from work, she demanded him to take those bags and get out. When she did that, surprisingly, her husband took those bags, loaded them into his car, and left without saying a word. She had some hope for her husband, but when he left without saying anything, her hopes were dashed and she fainted on the spot. When she woke up, she felt a deep resentment in her heart from that time on. Later, this lady learned that her husband rented an apartment and was living with the other woman. She felt that the situation was so bad, she could not even cry. She tried to forget about her husband with all kinds of effort. Days went by and resentment accumulated. One layer after another. Her mind and body grew weaker and she could sleep only after taking sleeping pills only. She could digest her food only after taking digestive aids. And she felt no enthusiasm about any kind of work. She lived such a life for a little more than 10 years. So her mind and body became very sick. She was groaning with sickness. Can you give me some juice? She was groaning with sickness that medicine cannot heal, and she was feeling a resentment that no one could solve. She wanted to kill. She wanted to commit suicide, but because of her responsibility for her children, she could not bring herself to commit such a crime. Now I could understand what she meant when she said, "I'm afraid that I may forgive my husband." This woman had the pain of losing her husband, and now she had the sickness of hating her husband as an enemy. But it would be very strange if she was not also physically sick. The Bible says, love your enemy. When hate our enemy is not suffering, but we suffer because we hate. Therefore, Lord Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. When we love our neighbor, that love is reflected back to us. If you want to make others upset, first we must be upset. If we try to please others, first we must be pleased. This is another law of nature. All of God's words are a blessing for our benefit. God says that the words that we cannot obey in our own strength, He will do. His words are His promises and His permission, and we will be able to obey. After I heard all of this woman's tearful story, I asked her, when your sister lived for more than 10 years hating your husband, was all of this helpful for you? Or was it painful? It has been painful. Then are you going to continue to live in this pain? Or would you like to end your pain here? She was silent. A little while later, she spoke again. Even though I might die by this pain, I cannot forgive him. Then the rest of your life, you will have more sickness and there will be more pain in your heart. Still, will you not forgive him? She was silent for a while. The woman who held such deep resentment and pain could not be helped by anyone. Though someone might say, forget about it, she could not easily put it out of her mind. The only doctor who can heal this enemy sickness is Lord Jesus Christ. Only the one who created our minds can heal the damaged heart. About a week later, in one of my morning lectures, I talked about the love of the cross. Mrs. Choi is continuing the story. Though I tried hard to explain this topic, I experienced how difficult it is to explain God's love with human lips. God's love is so magnanimous. So based on my experience, I diligently lectured to the best of my ability. Tears flowed in the eyes of that woman. Just like the sap flows in the tree and blood flows in our body, love must flow in our mind. Only when we allow the love of Jesus Christ that led him to give his life for sinners to flow in us, only then can we forgive our enemies. And our damaged heart can be healed. Forgiveness is not for others. It is for myself. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, says the Lord in Romans 12:19. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. So after the morning lecture, everyone went to the cafeteria. But this woman locked herself in her room and she knelt before God. She began to see herself in the light of holy love from the cross. She began to see that her mind was filled with pride, selfishness, hatred, jealousy, and envy. The woman was so proud that she did not even plead with her departing husband to remain with her and plead for his love. And she was full of confidence, so smart and so proud. All of this made him feel that she was too much to live with. That is why he left without a word. One by one, she began to examine herself and see her problems. Gradually, she began to understand her husband and to realize that the trouble was not with him, but with her. The sinner who needed forgiveness was not her husband, but herself. And she knelt down before the cross. The Lord of love finally came into this pitiful woman's heart. When the meal time was over and I was taking a walk, Mrs. Choi continues, that woman approached me. In her eyes, there was still evidence of her tears. But in her heart, the long, lingering cloud was blown away, and her expression was full of morning sunlight, bright and cheery. Amen. Praise the Lord. When a man kneels down before the cross, he is arriving at the highest point that a human being can ever reach. The words flowing out of the woman's mouth were an impressive testimony of one who received the love of the cross. She made up her mind to give up the evil thoughts toward her husband with regret and repentance, and she would live a new life. She said to Mrs. Choi, "Director, thank you." With tears in her eyes, she hugged me. The chronic enemy illness that no human doctor could heal now disappeared. As long as the cross between two people, as long as there is a cross between the two people, the cross of Jesus Christ, the enemy sickness will disappear. Do not seek revenge. If you seek revenge to your enemy, you are hurting yourself. Hatred and a spirit of revenge is originally from Satan. So whoever has that spirit will have misfortune. As I see that I am the worst sinner and I recognize God's forgiveness and love, only then can I forgive my enemy. That's why forgiveness is another name for love. God makes no allowance for us to not to choose to forgive and love. This must be our character in order to receive eternal life. When we are unjustly accused and rejected, now let me say, I have personally gone through all of this. I have been personally accused and rejected. So when we are unjustly accused and rejected, we must not look at our miserable self, but think deeply about Jesus. When Jesus was ridiculed, mocked, and put to shame, he did not seek revenge. He was mocked, but did not mock others. He did not respond to the cruel human whippings with threats. Instead, he entrusted himself with the one who will judge righteously. And when we suffer pain, he wants us to leave all to him instead of holding it to ourselves and suffering whole life. The word of God says in Isaiah 53 verse 4, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted." Philippians 2 verse 5 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." May the Lord bless us, that we may have that mind also, which was in Christ Jesus. who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, that he suffered the death, even the death of the cross. But he bore it all for us. And compared to what he went through, what we go through in our life is nothing, no matter how bad it be. May I invite you to kneel with me as we make a complete surrender before the cross of Calvary, that Jesus may come into our lives and heal our enemy sickness, that we too may be healed. Our gracious Father in heaven, thank you so much for what you did for us on the cross of Calvary. Thank you so much for these testimonies that are recorded for us, that we may learn to trust in you, that you will make all things right. May not be in this life, may be in the future life. When Jesus comes in the clouds of glory, that time he will make all things new. Help us to wait patiently for that great day. In the meanwhile, we make a complete surrender to thee, that you would come into our hearts, that we may have that mind of Jesus, who humbled himself so much to death, even to the death of the cross. He had no sin in him, but we are sinners. How dare we expect to be treated differently or better? Forgive us for our self-importance to the extent that we hate those people who do not like us or who have done things against us. Lord, gracious Lord, please help us to forgive them because you have forgiven us. Help us to forgive them because you have forgiven them when Jesus died on the cross for them also. So in the light of the cross, may that light shed on our lives, in our hearts, that forgiveness may be as easy for us as it was for you. Thank you, Father, that you are able to do all things abundantly more than we think, imagine, or ask for. We commit each one on this Zoom forum to your care and keeping. Create in each one of us a new heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us, that we may teach others thy ways and that the sinners may be converted to thee, and may the sinners be healed. Thank you, Father. As you are healing us, may others be healed too. We pray in the sweet and dear name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.